Well, good morning and welcome to Plantation Community Church. I'm Pastor Ray, and I'm so glad that you've joined us here this morning as we worship our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, together. Plantation Community is a Christ-centered, Bible-believing, and missions-minded church. We're a family where every believer is encouraged to grow in worship, in fellowship, in service, and in prayer. If you would like more information about our church, please contact us either through email or you can call the church office. We have many opportunities for you to grow in your faith. And of course, our greatest desire is that you would know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. If this is your first time checking us out, we extend a special welcome to you. Please send us an email and introduce yourself to us so that we can get to know you better. But we're going to be getting started soon. So once again, thank you for joining us. We trust that God is going to speak to you in a special way through the service this morning. God bless you, and I will see you in just a few minutes. Well, good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Plantation Community Church. Those of you here in person, those of you online, we are so glad to be meeting together this Lord's Day to worship our Heavenly Father, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in and through the power of the Holy Spirit. What a privilege we have to gather each week in Jesus' name. I'm Pastor Ray. We welcome you all. And if this is your first time here on a Sunday morning, we extend a special welcome to you. We're so glad that God has brought you to be here with us today. Let me share just a couple of announcements with you as we get started. First of all, adult Sunday school was scheduled to begin today, but our Sunday school teachers are not feeling well today. One of them was not feeling well, and so we're going to hold that off till next week. And just a reminder for all of us, a part of our safety protocols during this time of COVID is if any of us aren't feeling well, you know, we ask, please stay home and watch the service at home. But, you know, as long as you're feeling good and healthy, boy, we love having you here.
So adult Sunday school now will begin next week, if you're planning on staying for that after the service today. Children's choirs are meeting this afternoon as usual, but next week they will also be shifting into the morning. And they'll be meeting during the adult Sunday school hour right after the service, and that way parents of kids can stay for the Sunday school class as well. So that change will take place next week. Wednesday, we have our adult choirs online. We're looking to get our women's online Bible study starting soon. The materials have been ordered, and so we'll get you some information on that. There will be no Vespers online this week. I'll be away this week, and so we'll hold that off until next week. And so no Vespers online this Wednesday. We'll pick that up a week from Wednesday. However, Saturday night, we have our Saturday night fellowship, third Saturday of each month out in the back parking lot. This time, because we didn't get a chance, we won't have a chance to do our October Fall Festival. We're going to do a church picnic on the lawn. So if you come 5 o'clock Saturday and just bring a picnic supper with you, we won't be providing food. You need to bring your own. But bring some lawn chairs and a picnic meal. We'll share some food out in the lawn together, socially distanced. We'll also have a time of singing and fellowship and devotion in the church parking lot. So that's Saturday at 5 p.m. You'll notice in your worship guide there are two inserts. I'm going to ask Steve Brightcruz to come forward at this time as well. But one is a giving update, just so you can see where we are as far as our giving as a church. And then the other one has to do with Pastor Appreciation Month. I'm going to ask Steve Brightcruz, our senior deacon, just to share a word on that. Thank you, Steve.
Good morning. It's great to have this opportunity to speak to you just for a few minutes. October is Pastor Appreciation Month. And praise God, we have a lot to appreciate. So I wanted to just spend a few minutes with you, kind of highlight that for you. You know, during these times, the COVID times, it kind of feels like, and certainly to a degree, things have scaled back. But let me tell you, talking to our pastors from their perspective and what they have to do and how they've had to adjust and how they've had to research, you know, protocols and what's going on in other churches, what's going on in our community, what's going on, you know, as far as safety and all the ways to do it. So they have been busy. They do so much for us. They're caring for us all the time. So I just wanted to take this moment and encourage you, if you feel led, to express to them your appreciation through a gift card or some other way of giving. We can give either in the box in the back, but if you do that, please just write on there Pastor Appreciation so that it's segregated from the rest of it. And you can also go online, and there's actually a special category that's set up there. And then also you could just mail it in if you wanted to, mail it into the office. We are truly blessed in this church with the pastors we have, and it's great to have this opportunity to thank them. So thanks for the opportunity to kind of encourage you there. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Appreciate that. And then a final announcement is we still have shoe boxes out there, and they're getting sparse. We have some more. We need to put them out, but take as many as you would like to fill, and we're targeting for the first Sunday in November to get those back to the church. That's all the announcements at this time. So, Pastor Dan, will you come forward and lead us in our call to worship?
Good morning, everybody. I'm going to be opening worship today with Psalm 108. And one of the lines in Psalm 108 is, it says, "I will awaken the dawn with harp and lyre." And a story happened this morning in our family. My daughter, who lives in Europe, was awoken early in the morning by a strange sound in the living room, coming from the living room. So they went downstairs to see what that sound might be. And it was her two daughters on YouTube learning how to yodel. So awaken the dawn with a yodel or a harp and lyre, whatever it is, we will awaken the Lord and awaken the dawn. But here's Psalm 108. Says, "My heart, O God, is steadfast. I will sing and make music with all my soul. Awake, harp and lyre. I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love, higher than the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Let us pray. Father God, we lift our hearts and our hands to you in prayer. Lord, we want to just put the busyness of our week behind us and just settle our souls in focusing on you and worshiping you and loving you and giving you praise and thanks for all that you do in our lives. And so, Lord, as we sing this morning, we sing out our praise songs to you. Just know that they are coming from our heart and our soul, and that we love you with all of our hearts. And so, God, just enjoy this time of praise, because we do it for you. Amen.
Well, our message a little bit later this morning is going to be about how New Testament faith is better than Old Testament faith, because Jesus, the Messiah, has come. And so our praise song this morning and our hymn both have to do with Christ coming as the Messiah. Will you please stand with me and let us lift our voices in praise to the Lord. Jesus, Messiah. He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing, Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed be the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, love so amazing, Jesus the Messiah. Lord of all,
going to sing hymn number 244, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Continue our worship with prayer, joining our hearts together. Father God, we thank you so much for Jesus. Jesus came and he made us right. Jesus came and showed us the pure, sacred, and holy love of God. Jesus came and he went to the cross to take the burden of sin from all of humanity. And Lord God, because of that great cross work, we were able to be free to be in front of you and even to pray to you right now, God. And not only that, Lord God, that we are able to live a life where we are preparing ourselves for life eternal in heaven. Every day, learning to be more like you, Jesus, and we thank you for that. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for guiding us, for keeping us informed through the word. And as we read the word, God, we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you enlighten the word and you make the word alive, and the word of God becomes our guide and our focus for living. Thank you so much for that, God. So God, now as we move into worship, we also pray that you ask that you instill in us a desire to let people who haven't yet come to know Jesus, know that he has come and who he is. Thank you for all of these things, Lord God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And now it's time to say hello to one another, but the children are now to leave and go to children's church. But remember, folks, here in the sanctuary, turn around and wave hi to the people at home through the screen over there in the window.
Got it.
Our first reading this morning comes from the book of Jeremiah, the 31st chapter, verses 31 through 34. The time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their forefathers when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel. After that time, declares the Lord, I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will a man teach his neighbor or a man his brother, saying, know the Lord, because they will all know me, for the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness, and I will remember their sins no more. The word of God.
Beautiful. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Anne. As we move to our time of prayer as a church family, our missionary prayer focus this week is Ryan and Mandy Kennedy. You say, well, didn't we just pray for some Kennedys last week? Yep, last week we prayed for Walter and Diane Kennedy. Ryan is Walter and Diane's son, and he grew up in Indonesia, out on the mission field with his parents, and now he and his wife Mandy and their daughter are also out in Indonesia serving the Lord. So it's just a wonderful thing that God is doing there. Please remember Ryan and Mandy in your personal times of prayer this week. Let's go to the Lord together now in prayer as a family. Well, Father God, we just thank you so much for the amazing privilege we have of coming to you in prayer. Lord, you are in heaven, we are on earth. And you tell us that therefore our words should be few. But Lord, when we are praying to you, we want our words to pour forth in praise and glory and honor to you. And we thank you that through Jesus, our words span that gap. And Lord, you hear all that we pray to you in Christ. We continue to pray concerning the coronavirus. We just pray, Lord, for continued protection and healing. We pray for the medical solutions that are getting closer. We thank you for the new treatments that are already some of them in place that are helping people. Lord, we pray for anyone struggling with the coronavirus even today. We pray for your healing for them. Lord, we pray for Odalis Aristizabal, one of the members of our church who was tested positive for COVID. And we just pray, Lord, that you would be with her. Brenda is with us today, Lord. Her brother is struggling, and we pray for healing for him. We continue to pray for Edie Webster and Lourdes Hauglord, and for Pastor Chip and Barbara Plank. And Lord, we do lift up Ryan and Mandy Kennedy to you. We thank you, Lord, that they have returned to the mission field, and they are there serving you, Lord. We pray that you would provide for all their needs, that you would watch over them and their family, that you would bless them in the gospel work that they are doing. Lord, you have instructed us in your word to pray for our government and our leaders, and so we do pray for all of our government leaders today, for the president and vice president, cabinet and advisors. We pray for those in Congress. We pray for state officials. We pray for our local government leaders. Lord, we pray for each one that you would guide them in the decisions they make, to help them make good and righteous decisions, wise decisions that will allow us to continue our freedom to share the gospel with others and to live out our faith. We have an election coming up, and so, Lord, we certainly pray for this election and that you would guide each of us in our voting. And, Lord, we entrust the election into your hands as well. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, if you'll please take your Bibles and turn with me to Hebrews chapter 11. You might say, boy, we've been doing that a lot lately, turning to Hebrews chapter 11. Well, today is the last message in our series now from Hebrews chapter 11, Growing in Faith. We started this series back in May, and we've had, this will be our 18th message, and I hope you've enjoyed working your way through this chapter and through this series as much as I've enjoyed preparing it and presenting these messages for you. But more than just enjoying it, I hope that you have truly benefited from it. You know, in just another 30 minutes, we will have completed an in-depth study on probably the most important chapter in the entire Bible dealing with the topic of faith. And my twofold prayer as we've studied this chapter for all of us has been this. Number one, that each of us would gain a better understanding of what true biblical faith is all about. And then number two, that we would all grow in our own personal faith as followers of Jesus. You know, you will find an insert in your bulletin with the outline for today's message, but also in the back of that, there's an outline for the entire message series. And I would encourage you to tuck that away somewhere. If you have a notebook where in which you take notes, you could put it in there. Also, in your online email that you got this morning, your online worship, there's a link in that email to a PDF with all of the outlines to the whole series, all 18 messages, if you would like to access that at home and print that out. I would encourage you to maybe this week to take some time and to reread Hebrews chapter 11 and maybe just have this mini outline here from your bulletin by your side. And as you read each section, just look at the title for that message and reflect on these wonderful truths of biblical faith that we've explored together in these past weeks. You know, we've invested a lot of time in this chapter, and I truly believe that if we each put a little extra effort now in the end to prayerfully review what God has taught you, that will be well worth your time. So we're at the end of the chapter now, just two verses, verses 39 and 40. Please stand with me now for the reading of God's word, Hebrews 11, verses 39 and 40. The chapter concludes this way. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. This is the word of God. Let us pray. Well, dear Lord, as we look into these final verses of this great chapter, once again, Holy Spirit, you inspired these words for our benefit. Now open our eyes and ears and hearts to hear the message you would have for us today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. You know, there are some situations in life where the old is better than the new. Where the old is better than the new. For example, when it comes to a piece of finely crafted furniture or certain musical instruments. Many times the older handcrafted pieces are far superior in quality to those newer, cheaper pieces that are just coming off the assembly line. But you know, then there are other situations where the newer items are superior to the old. For example, I imagine most of you with computers would probably not want to trade in your newest model for the one that you had 10 or even 20 years ago. I don't think any of us are going to sign up for that. I remember my first computer back in the 1980s. Right? Didn't even have a hard drive, right? Just had the two floppy drives. Yeah, some of you remember that? And you had to swap back and forth those just to make it work. You know, when it comes to computers, newer is definitely better. Well, we've been studying Hebrews chapter 11, and Hebrews chapter 11 has been talking about faith. Hebrews chapter 11 has dug deep back into the Old Testament for examples of true biblical faith. And these have all been wonderful examples, haven't they? We've learned so much from the faith of these Old Testament persons, people like Abraham and Isaac and Moses. But now when we come to these last two verses in the chapter, these last two verses now move us from the experience of Old Testament believers, from the experience of Old Testament believers to that of New Testament believers. And in doing so, Hebrews chapter 11 emphatically states that as wonderful, as inspiring as Old Testament faith was, New Testament faith is even better. Now, this was important to the original readers of this letter of Hebrews because, as we've stated several times in our study in this chapter, many of them were tempted. They were tempted to abandon Christianity, right, and return to Judaism. In other words, they were tempted to leave New Testament faith behind and return to Old Testament faith. And the writer of Hebrews chapter 11 says that would be a huge mistake. Because even though there's so much we can learn from Old Testament faith, New Testament faith is vastly superior in every way. So it's important for the original readers to understand. You know, it's important for us to understand too. You know why? Because this is where we live. We live in New Testament times. So that's the question we want to explore today. Why is New Testament faith better than Old Testament faith? And as we look at our two verses this morning, we're going to see three reasons why New Testament faith is better. Once again, there's an outline in your worship guide if you want to take that out and follow along. Reason number one is this. Old Testament believers were commended for their faith, yet they did not receive the promise. Let me say that again. First reason why New Testament faith is better than Old Testament is because Old Testament believers, yes, they were commended for their faith, but they did not receive the promise. So let's look at verse 39 together now. It says this. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. Now, this verse here says that all of these were commended for their faith. That phrase, these all, you know what that refers to? That's referring back to the entire chapter that we've just looked at. All of these Old Testament persons of faith that we've been studying these past weeks, Abel, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Joseph, Moses, Joshua, Rahab, the judges, David, Samuel, and the prophets. You go, yeah, I guess we have been studying this since May, haven't we? That's a lot of names. You know, at the beginning of this chapter, two names were singled out, Abel and Enoch, the first two, and they were specifically mentioned as being commended for their faith. But now we get to verse 39, and verse 39 clarifies that even though only the first two were specifically commended, all of these people here in Hebrews 11 were commended for their faith. The author here repeats what he said at the very beginning of the chapter. This is what the ancients were commended for, namely their faith. Now, when we first looked at that word commended back in verse 2 of Hebrews chapter 11, we saw that it was a word that means this, to be given a good report. Remember, none of these Old Testament believers were perfect. Okay? None of them were perfect. They all had many faults, many failings in various subject areas, but they all got good grades when it came to the subject of faith. God commended them. God gave them a good report for their faith, even to the point of including their names here in Hebrews chapter 11, which is sort of a dean's list or honor roll of faith. And you know what? There's a great variety in this list of peoples that we've been studying here in Hebrews 11. Some were wealthy, others were poor. Most of them were Jewish, although Rahab was a Gentile. Men and women are both mentioned. As we saw last week, some of them experienced great victories through their faith, while others experienced great suffering. And yet they all shared one common bond together. Faith is the common bond that ties all these people together in one list. They all had faith, and they were all commended by God for their faith. Once again, this is such an important principle for each of us to grasp. Faith and love are what matter most to God. Faith and love are what matter most to God. You know, other people may judge you on the basis of your job or your clothes, your home or your car, but you know what? None of those things are going to endure past this lifetime. Your faith has eternal value, and God will richly reward you for your faith throughout all of eternity. So Hebrews 11:39 tells us these were all commended for their faith, but it goes on to say this, that none of them received what had been promised. None of them received what had been promised. You know what? We peeked ahead to this verse a few weeks ago when we were studying verse 33. Verse 33, which speaks of the heroes of the faith who gained what was promised. And we learned at that time that there are actually three different verses here in Hebrews chapter 11, three verses which speak about Old Testament believers either receiving or not receiving what was promised. Let me give you all three verses right now. Verse 13 says this, they did not receive the things promised. That's verse 13. Verse 33 says this, they gained what was promised, says that they did. Verse 39 says, none of them received what was promised. And you go, what's going on here? Why are all these differences? Did they receive these promises or didn't they? And what we need to understand is that all three of these verses, they're talking about three different things, right? We learned that verse 13 refers to who? Just the patriarchs. Speaking of the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who lived in the promised land as strangers, while they waited for God's promise of the land to be fulfilled. They died still waiting in faith. They did not receive what was promised. Why? Because God didn't promise to give it to them. He promised to give the land to their descendants, not to them personally. And then we saw that in verse 33, this phrase translated what was promised in verse 33 that they received is actually the word promises, okay? Promises in the plural. We saw that verse 33 refers to the many promises, the many promises that God fulfilled to his people, which they gained through faith. And we looked at some examples. Noah and his family were saved from the flood. Abraham and Sarah received their promised son Isaac, and so on. So in verse 33, the word promise was in the plural when it said they did receive the promises. Here in verse 39, very important, now the word promise is in the singular. And so here in verse 39 now, it does not refer to the many Old Testament promises that God made to his people along the way. There were a lot of them. No, it refers to the one promise. The main overarching promise of the entire Old Testament, the promise of the coming of the Messiah. The ultimate promise of the Old Testament was none other than the coming of Jesus Christ, the Messiah of God. And you know what? Not one of these Old Testament heroes of faith lived to see that promise fulfilled. They all died before Christ came. So that's our first reason this morning. Why is New Testament faith better than Old Testament faith? Reason number one, Old Testament believers, yeah, they were commended for their faith, but they did not receive the promise, the ultimate promise of the Old Testament. That brings us now to the second reason why New Testament faith is better than Old Testament faith. And here's the second reason. God had planned something better for us in the New Testament. God planned something better for us in the New Testament. Look at the beginning of verse 40 now, where, well, actually it says exactly that. That's where we got it from. God had planned something better for us. You know, the word they back in verse 39, that refers to the Old Testament believers. The word us here in verse 40, that refers to us, to New Testament believers. God planned something better for us in the New Testament. And as we've already seen, that something was the coming of Jesus into the world. Now, I want us to focus on that word planned for a moment, where verse 40 says God planned this something better for us. And the word that's translated planned here in this verse, it's a word which means to foresee or to provide, to foresee or to provide. So that tells us that when God planned this something better for us, he foresaw our need for a Savior. He foresaw our need for a Savior, and he provided that Savior for us through the giving of his own Son, Jesus Christ. You know, the Bible tells us that God had planned this out long ago, long before even the time of the Old Testament, long before he even created the world. From before the beginning of time, God planned and provided something better for us, the coming of his Son, Jesus, into the world to be a Savior for mankind. Now, this word that's translated better here in verse 40, better. God planned something better. It's a word that's used 18 times in the New Testament. But here's what's real interesting. 14 out of those 18 times are all in the book of Hebrews. It's only used four times outside of the book of Hebrews. 14 of them are right here in the book of Hebrews. And that's because this concept of things being better in Christ, that is one of the major themes of the whole book of Hebrews. And Hebrews is full of examples of how things are better now that Jesus has come. Let me share with you a list of the something betters that you find here in the book of Hebrews. Here we go. Hebrews chapter 1, 4 speaks of Christ as being better than the angels. Hebrews 6, 9 speaks of a better salvation. Hebrews 7, 19 speaks of a better hope. Hebrews 7:22 speaks of a better covenant. Hebrews 8:6 speaks of better promises. Hebrews 9:23 speaks of a better sacrifice. We'll talk about that towards the end of the message. Hebrews 10:34 speaks of better and lasting possessions. Hebrews 11:16 speaks of a better country. Hebrews 11:35 speaks of a better resurrection. Hebrews 12:24 describes the sprinkled blood of Jesus that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See, the whole point of the book of Hebrews is this: things are better. Things are better now that Jesus has come. Through Christ, God has provided a better sacrifice, a better salvation, better promises, a better hope. And you know what? The Bible also tells us how the Old Testament believers, how they longed for these better days of the New Testament. They longed for it. We read in the book of 1 Peter about the prophets who searched intently to discern the time and the circumstances of Christ's coming and the salvation he would bring. Let me read to you from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 10 through 12. It says, concerning this salvation, the prophets who spoke of the grace that was to come to you, they searched intently and with the greatest care, trying to find out the time and the circumstances to which the Spirit of Christ in them was pointing when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you. They were serving you, and they spoke of the things that have now been told you by those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. And then I like this little thing at the end here, this little tag. Even angels long to look into these things. And so the entire Old Testament was looking forward to the New Testament. And in Old Testament times, prophets and angels alike searched longingly for the clues to Christ's coming. You know, we look back at this list of Old Testament heroes in Hebrews chapter 11, and we just marvel at this list, don't we? These are the giants of the faith in the Old Testament. We look at what they did, and we look at what they accomplished through their faith, and we wonder, could we do that? Could we ever measure up to that? And yet, as wonderful as their faith was, not one of them received what had been promised. Not one of them lived to see the coming of Christ into the world. And no matter how great their faith was, you know what? None of it mattered apart from the coming of Christ. So that's the second reason why New Testament faith is better than Old Testament faith. We are privileged to live in New Testament times because God planned something better for us in the coming of Jesus. And then there's a third reason why New Testament faith is better than Old Testament faith. We find this in verse 40. Old Testament believers are not complete without New Testament believers. Old Testament believers, everyone we've just read about in Hebrews chapter 11, Old Testament believers, they are not complete without New Testament believers. Let's go back to verse 40 now. And let's read the whole verse. God had planned something better for us so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Old Testament believers are not complete without New Testament believers. That phrase that's translated made perfect here in verse 40, it's a word that means to perfect, to make perfect or complete, to accomplish the goal. So once again, Old Testament faith, as wonderful as it was, as inspiring as it was, as much as we can learn from it concerning growing in our own faith, it was still not complete in and of itself. It did not fully accomplish the goal. Old Testament faith looked forward to the time of Christ, and it would only be made perfect or complete in Christ. Remember, okay, I know we've said this over and over again, but remember, book of Hebrews was written to who? It was written to Jews who had become Christians, who were now being persecuted for their faith, and so they were tempted to return to Judaism. But what does verse 40 tell us now? It says that Judaism is not complete by itself. The whole purpose of Judaism was to prepare the world for Christ. As Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1 says, the law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. So the law was the shadow, but the reality is found in Christ. And now that Christ has come, Judaism is obsolete. It only becomes complete in Christ, in Jesus the Messiah. And that's why Jews who become Christians today often refer to themselves not as converted Jews. No, they like to call themselves completed Jews. Completed Jews. Because together with us, they have been completed or made perfect in Christ. Old Testament faith, yeah, wonderful. But New Testament faith, oh, so much better. Old Testament faith laid the foundation, but New Testament faith built the house. Old Testament believers were credited with righteousness in advance of Christ's coming, but New Testament believers, we have the righteousness of Christ imputed to us. That means that we are given, we are actually infused with the righteousness of Jesus. We read this in 2 Corinthians 5:21 concerning Jesus. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us. Christ took our sin. Why? So that in him we might become the righteousness of God. We actually receive the righteousness of Jesus into our lives. Old Testament faith was forward-looking. It looked forward to the time of Christ. New Testament faith is both backward and forward-looking, right? We look back to the finished work of Christ on the cross, which has accomplished our salvation, and we look forward to the second coming of Christ, when God will establish his kingdom. And so this third reason why New Testament faith is better than Old Testament faith, this is amazing. Think about it. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, these giants of faith in the Old Testament, they all needed us. They needed us. You know, we needed them to help point us to Christ, but they needed us before their faith could be made complete. And so we are part of their story, and you know what? They are part of ours. So the Old Testament heroes of the faith and New Testament believers in Christ, we are all one family together in Jesus. New Testament faith is better than Old Testament faith because Old Testament believers are not complete without New Testament believers. So let's try to bring this all together now. What does all of this mean? It means this, that because Christ has come, we who live in the time of the New Testament, we have certain privileges, certain blessings that the Old Testament believers never experienced. We looked at some of these already in the list of betters in the book of Hebrews. They were scattered throughout the whole book, right? A better hope, better promises, better salvation now that Jesus has come. And why are all these things better? Let me give you two reasons in closing. One reason these things are better is because we have a better revelation of God in Christ. We have a better revelation of God in Christ. We read this in Hebrews chapter 1, the very opening verses of the book that we've been studying. It says this, "In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways, but in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son." And yes, God revealed so much about himself to those in the Old Testament, but we have a much fuller revelation of God given to us in Jesus. When Philip, one of Jesus' disciples, said to him, "Lord, show us the Father." I love what Jesus replied. He said, "Don't you know me, Philip? Don't you know me even after I've been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father." And when you and I, when we read the Gospels, when we look at Jesus in the Gospels, you know what you're looking at? You see God through Jesus Christ. And so we have a better revelation of God in Christ. And then secondly, these things are better because we have a better relationship with God through Christ. Because Jesus has come, because Jesus has died and resurrected, because Jesus has ascended to heaven, Jesus has sent his Holy Spirit now to live within us and to be with us forever. And through the Holy Spirit, God the Father and Jesus the Son and the Holy Spirit all come to live within us. Jesus said this in John 14, 23. He said, "If anyone loves me, he will obey my teaching. My Father will love him and we will come to him. We'll make our home with him." You say, "Well, I want that. Who gets that? Whoever loves me and obeys my teaching." What does it mean to love Christ and to obey his teaching? It means to place your faith in Jesus as Savior and to live that faith out in love for God and Christ. And all of this is only possible because of the better sacrifice that Jesus made for you and me. Anybody want to go back to sacrificing bulls and goats and lambs? Anybody wants to set up the altar up here and have the animals up here and the knives and all of that? No. See, Jesus is the better sacrifice. Made one sacrifice for all sins, for all time, at the cross, so that you and I could be saved. Why does all this matter? We saw that it mattered to the original readers because they were tempted to go back to Judaism. But now that Christ has come, Christianity is infinitely better than Judaism. Old Testament faith is incomplete without New Testament faith. It matters to us, folks, because Jesus makes all the difference. He makes all the difference. If you've never placed your faith in Jesus Christ before, let me tell you this morning, God has something better for you. Nothing is better in life. Nothing is more important in life than knowing God through Jesus Christ. Another reason it matters to us is because to whom much has been given, much is required. You know, those in the Old Testament, we've learned, they were commended for their faith. They lived exemplary lives of faith before God, even without the full revelation of Christ that we have today. And if they were able to live those lives of faith before Christ came, how much more should we live our lives of faith that are pleasing to God now that Christ has come? We who have the greater privilege, we who have something better, we who have Jesus, we have an even greater responsibility to live a life of faith than those in the Old Testament. Finally, the overall application for the entire chapter of Hebrews chapter 11, the overall application for all of this is actually found in the next chapter. We're not going to be studying Hebrews chapter 12, but we're just going to peek at the first two verses, which says this: therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, and I believe that refers to the people we've just been studying in Hebrews chapter 11, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Here it comes now. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. We've learned so much about faith from these Old Testament heroes, and now it's time to put it all into practice as we fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Well, dear Lord, what an awesome privilege it has been for us to spend these months here in Hebrews chapter 11. To learn all of these important principles about how we are to demonstrate our faith, that true faith expresses itself in action. And Lord, we've learned so many specific ways that we can express our faith in action. So Lord Jesus, as we now fix our eyes on you, the author of our faith, the one who gets us all started, the perfecter of our faith, the one, Lord, you are going to perfect us and complete us. Our prayer is the same as that of the disciples who came to you so many years ago. And they said, Lord, increase our faith. So, Lord Jesus, we submit ourselves to you and your word, and we say, Lord, increase our faith. Help us to grow in our faith as followers of you, Lord Jesus. It is in your precious name that we pray. Amen. Amen. This concludes our service for this week. Don't forget, there will be no Vespers online this week on Wednesday. We'll pick up the following week. We do have the Saturday night fellowship out in the church parking lot this Saturday at 5 p.m. Receive now the benediction. Go now in the grace of God our Father, who planned something better for you and for me in Jesus. Go forth to grow in your faith in Christ. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week in the Lord.